Welcome to another workshop offered by the University of Kentucky and the Office of Work Life. This month's topic, we're going to be talking about using music for your mental health. And our guest speaker is Eric Wilkinson. He is one of our therapists in human resources, and he has an LCSW. And I'm going to turn it over to Eric. Thank you for being here, Eric.
Yeah, it's great to be here. Hello, everyone. I assume that most folks that have arrived today are here because you love music. And so what I've designed is a presentation that both kind of talks about the research-based benefits of music for positive mental health. And then also I've planned a activity at the end, time permitting, where I will play some songs with some questions for you all to respond to the individual songs. Not just for yourself. It's not, the responses are not going to be shared publicly or anything like that. It's just it's a music therapy activity that was taught to me a long time ago that I've used with different clients at different times in my practice. I am one of the four full-time therapists in UK Health and Wellness. If you go look at the Work Life and Wellbeing website, you can see profiles for four full-time therapists, and then we also have three part-time therapists. And every UK employee, spouse, dependent gets 5-3 free counseling sessions per fiscal year, and it's not part of your medical record, it's not part of your employee record. Since it's not part of your medical record and we're not billing insurance, we don't provide any formal diagnosis. But all four of us are licensed therapists and have had, you know, decades of experience doing therapy. So if there's anything you want to talk about, it can be traditional mental health issues like anxiety and stress, depression, grief, relationship problems, it can be personal, work related, either one. But even if you just want to come in because you're trying to think through what your life goals are, or maybe you want to learn some new skills, we all have different areas of expertise. I tend to a lot of my training and background and is kind of in mindfulness-based psychotherapy and compassion-based psychotherapy. So with that, I'll go ahead and get started. And at the very beginning, I am going to ask for folks that are willing to respond to a question in the chat. So this is just saying what we're going to be doing. We're going to be going through the therapeutic benefits of music. And then, like I said, time permitting at the end, we're going to do a music therapy activity that can be helpful in building insight. The prompt I want is I want you to pause for a moment and think, if you were a song, what song would you be and why? If you were a song, what song would you be and why? And then if you feel comfortable putting in the chat, Zeta, if you're willing, maybe you can read the responses that people put into the chat. So this is just activating, you know, our emotional parts of our brain and letting us arrive in this present moment. So if you were a song, what song would you be and why? And it doesn't, also it can be what song would you be right now in this moment, or it could be what song would you be in any moment.
We have a couple of responses. So I'll read them all for you. One says, someone said, "This is me." And "Highway to Hell," but that feels a bit morbid. Nocturne, it says, "It's a lovely, peaceful waltz." Oh, okay. Because they love to move around like the song. Nice. Mm-hmm. "Happy" by Pharrell, because I'm happy. Depends on the day. Yesterday was "Creep" by Radiohead. "No Rain" by Blind Melon. Just really love this song. "Well Traveled" by Janet Jackson. "Ramble on Rose." Love the journey the music takes you on. Let's see. I feel like I missed one up. Let me see here.
It's interesting, folks. Name some of my favorite songs just in this list.
Okay, I got that one. Let me go down the list here a little bit. Let's see. "Sail" by AWOL Nation, Defying Gravity. It speaks to my own experiences and aspirations. Love the power, possibility in the music and the lyrics. Home by Talking Heads, or Sean Colvin, or anything from Leonard Cohen. I'm Every Woman. Learning to Fly by Tom Petty, because it is encouraging and coming of age. That's all we have right now.
I love it. We'll pause there. Person I mentioned, Leonard Cohen, may be happy if you're able to stick around because that part of my music montage has a little bit of Leonard Cohen in it. What I would like for you all to think about is the songs that you identified for yourself. Think back to what age you were when you first heard that song. And from a research-based perspective, the greatest odds are that you are between the ages, if we want to be as precise as possible, there's a good chance you were between the ages of 18 and 24 when you heard that song. I'd say it's a really good chance that you're between the ages of 16 and 28. So just note that for yourself because we're going to come back to the significance of how our brain develops along with our musical tastes. If you look in the literature, there are established benefits of music. I am someone who I don't know if I ever go a day without music. And I, if you are someone who loves music, you're probably the same. You probably don't need my encouragement, but I would encourage folks, if you think about between listening to music and making music, I know I don't go through any days without music because, like probably many of you, I'm humming songs, singing songs, whether I'm listening to songs or actually, playing around with a musical instrument, which I'm not any experienced musician. I like to tell folks that, but I still like to dabble around with keyboards and other things just for fun. But most of the time, I probably like you, you're singing songs, humming songs, or listening to music, or if you are a musician, you're playing music. This has such great benefits in terms of self-expression, self-actualization, personal growth. It also has real benefits in terms of our mood and emotional regulation. It benefits our mind, our brain, the health of our brain. And it also creates a sense of connection with other human beings, a sense of community. In many ways, music is probably the most universal human artifact. Every society across time has had music. Music predates agriculture and likely predates language. The first instruments are thought to be that have been found are flutes and whistles that date back 50,000 to 60,000 years ago. The first known drum was 7,000 years ago. I think this third point on this slide is really powerful. If you think about it, almost every major life event we experience, we incorporate music into it. Whether it's comforting a child by singing them a lullaby, whether it's going through a religious ceremony, when we are together with friends and family for celebrations and parties, for anniversaries and birthdays, sporting events, we have music at our weddings, at our funerals. Music plays a big role when militaries go to war. Music is embedded in almost all major life events, which really speaks to the how central it is to our humanity. This is really interesting. Music can evoke emotion directly in our brains in a way that surpasses language or really any other art forms. This is one of the reasons why music plays such a huge role in the films we watch, because it can take us to an emotional place almost immediately, without having to explain anything or set up any kind of plot. What's really interesting is that as our brain develops, we develop these kind of neural pathways that experience music. And so when we're listening to music, our brain is shooting off neurons that are mirroring the music. For those who are old enough to remember boomboxes or stereos in the 80s and 90s, they used to have often this digital screen where you would see colors that would light up, you know, along with the intensity of the music or the pitch of the music. They would stay in rhythm with the music. I was thinking about how those kind of visual representations of the music and old stereos and boomboxes, it's sort of like what's happening within our own brains when it's firing off neurons. While music is universal, it's also very culturally specific. And so whatever culture you grow up in and whatever time period you grow up in, you internalize the rules for music. You internalize a sense of what notes go together and what progression of notes is pleasant and appealing. You internalize what a good melody sounds like. Music is very much a game of expectations. On the one hand, we like music to be familiar. We know what we like and we like to hear what we like. But we also like to be pleasantly surprised. If music is just, if it never changes or it doesn't surprise us in any way, then we tend to be bored with it. So it's kind of this balance where for the most part we like familiarity, but we also like to be surprised as long as it is not too extreme. Most people do not like very, very experimental music. I don't know if anyone in here has ever been, I don't even know if they, I'm assuming they still call it like a noise band where you'll have musicians just making noises with different electronic devices or just really it's like soundscapes. You know, for me, that's moving in the direction of, you know, too much unfamiliarity or too much experimentation for me to enjoy. Our neural pathways, they start developing based on the music we hear, even when we're in utero. By the age of 2, you can always already see cultural preferences for music. And people have learned the chord progression norms within their culture by the age of 5. In Western music, high notes convey excitement and low notes convey sadness. Major chords are triumphant and happy emotions. Minor chords are more often used for sad or reflexive emotions. And then going back to my point about adolescence, you know, while we grow up with music and it's from even before we're born, we're enjoying music, musical tastes really start to pick up for most people around age 10 and 11. And then our preferences during our late adolescence is really powerful. It's really impactful. The music that we listen to, you know, during adolescence is often the music that we listen to the rest of our life. If we think about self-actualization from a youth standpoint, we know that when children listen to music, they can, one, you know, again, let me revisit the idea of why we sing lullabies or why we sing to children, right? It's to help them to self-regulate when they're feeling overwhelming emotions. My earliest childhood memory was when I was under the age of 2 and I was visiting my grandmother in the Chicago area. And I can remember her rocking me and trying to put me to sleep. And I was in a, you know, a different house. It wasn't mine. And I even have the visual of the way there were shadows cast against the wall from a plant that was next to the window. And I can remember these feelings of anxiety and fear. But I also remember my grandmother singing to me and how soothing and calming that experience was. That's my earliest childhood memory. So we grow up learning to self-soothe, to regulate our emotions. Music becomes like a playground where we start to hear stories about the world, where we learn, we have to try to imagine the perspective of the songwriter or the characters in the song. We start to develop emotional intelligence and our language skills. As we move into adolescence, it becomes a big part of our identity and finding community. However, throughout life, music is very much a way to express our ideas, our values, our hopes, our fears, our desires, and our needs. On a very existential level, music for many, many of us is a way of saying what matters most. And let me share with you my experience of what I'm feeling, of what my life feels like. Music, I encourage folks and my clients to use music as a self-care practice. It's often beneficial to match up your mood, music that aligns with your mood, that can feel very validating and comforting. There's also times where it makes sense to choose music that is quite different than the mood you're in. And I think folks know this when they, if a lot of folks will use some really upbeat, you know, intense music if they're going to be working out or going to the gym. They may not be initially energized, but they choose music to energize themselves for their workout. I'm a big proponent with the folks I work with about using music to unblock emotion. So if somebody tells me that they're not feeling anything, I often will give different types of, you know, go back to music that you really love, or I'll ask people to create playlists for different time periods in their life. And sometimes when we're emotionally blocked, this releases emotions. Usually it releases emotions, again, because it kind of bypasses the thinking part of our brain, the language part of our brain. Music is available to us to both name our experiences and to make sense of the world. I'm someone who, when I'm trying to make sense of a situation, I think to myself, what is a song that would capture what is going on here? What's a song that would represent what this experience is about? I use music to actively interpret things that are happening in my life. Music is a resource for both self feelings of self-worth, particularly if we make music or, you know, participate in group singing or group music. It's also, again, a form of self-compassion, a way to be kind towards ourselves when we're experiencing pain or discomfort. As we age, music has a lot of potential benefit to help folks accept and process losses in their life. I mean, that's intrinsically part of aging is, you know, many losses, whether it's losses of people we love, losses of, you know, our physical health, our mobility, our energy levels. In my case, I lost my hair at a young age. You know, aging is full of losses. What we know is that when, particularly seniors, when they're engaging in music, this helps protect against emotional disorders and cognitive decline. If we think about mood and emotion, I've put together some of the research here. Group singing promotes positive mental health, feelings of joy, feelings of connection to others. It can also elicit transcendence, like you're transcending from your current moment. You're connecting to something bigger than yourself. It can create feelings of euphoria. And particularly with the group singing, at least some of the research seems to indicate that these benefits are even more pronounced for women. Singing, if we think about singing, including humming and mantras, we know that there is a rich body of research that shows that singing decreases stress and cortisol levels. It increases immunoglobulin, which is like an antibody for when we have respiratory infection, but it's also the presence of the immunoglobulin, and I may be saying that wrong, so apologize if I am, but it also is associated with relaxation and positive mood. We know that when we sing, particularly humming in mantras and singing, activates the vagus nerve, which creates feelings of calm and safety, lowers blood pressure, lowers heart rate. Making music or listening to music increases oxytocin, which is the bonding chemical the chemical that we feel when we're feeling close to somebody, or when we're feeling happiness in real connection. And music releases endorphins, which is one of the reasons why, whether we're experiencing physical pain or emotional pain, turning to music can be a really important form of self-care. If we think about the cognitive benefits, from a young age, like again, even in utero, when we listen to music, we're building neural pathways. Engaging with music, it creates a lot of connections within our brain that are provide us resources that can be beneficial throughout our lifespan. We know that folks that sing or play a musical instrument, it tends to improve their attention span, their executive functioning. When we either sing or listen to music, it improves our ability to imagine what other people's experiences are like. There is some research that suggests that playing a musical instrument may protect against cognitive decline and dementia. One study, I'm someone who currently provides some elder care. There's been research that shows that music can really improve relationships, memory, mood, and reduce stress for people with dementia, as well as for the caregivers of people with dementia. So there's really, really some exciting research. In many ways, some of the kind of the physical responses to music and the understanding that music reduces anxiety and stress and depression and improves moods, a lot of these things are highly established. And then other research is more emerging, but across the board, I think there's ample evidence to suggest that music can be helpful to us in many different life struggles. When we think about social connection, if we think about singing with a group or making music with a group, it requires you to be in contact with others. It requires to pay attention to the mental states of others. If you're listening, again, if you're listening to songs, you're imagining the world through the eyes of the songwriter. When we experience music with others, we're sharing emotion with others. This creates a sense of connection and social cohesion. Music very much is a form of communication. I know I've had a lot of folks that, you know, one of their primary ways of communicating with their partner is through sharing music. If we think about like just dancing to a song or clapping our hands, this requires coordination of action. And again, that kind of, you know, synchronizing ourselves with others, it creates a feeling of unity and belonging. It also creates a lot of pleasure. I mean, dancing is as old as music. Dancing and music go hand in hand. When our brain is processing music, a lot of the regions is where the brain processes music is the regions of our brain associated with movement. And so kind of like dancing and music are hand in hand. And they're really for folks that allow themselves to experience music kind of, you know, that statement, dance like no one's watching. You know, probably everybody here today knows that you can experience enormous pleasure through music. And we know that if you're going to play music with others, it requires shared goals, cooperation, practice, you know, teamwork. And so for all these reasons, it creates social connection. But there's also, in addition to, you know, singing with other people or playing music with other people, just sharing music with other people. There's the robust communities like, you know, online around different musical artists. You think about like Taylor Swift and like the enormous community that has emerged in response to her music. So I've actually done pretty well. This would be a good time to pause. Does anybody have any specific questions about anything that I covered? One of the things I will say that was not on the slide is that music is one of, when we're singing a song or we're making music, or even if we're deeply listening to music, it's one of the times where we can have a positive psychological flow state where we are completely immersed in the activity, where we lose our sense of time. And this is really important for our mental health because many of us spend the majority of our day completing tasks, meeting responsibilities. From a mindfulness-based cognitive therapy standpoint, we call that doing mode, where you're task directed. And there's often very little opportunity to just immerse yourself in an experience where it's like time stands still. So psychological flow state is something that we all need for our mental health, and music is one of the ways, one of the ways that we can experience that. I would also say that being intentional about the music you listen to. Sometimes we just put music on in the background, and there's nothing wrong with that. But also, like, if you are someone who has benefited from music in the past, trying to give yourself experiences where you're not distracted and you're totally engaged with the music. Azeta, do we have any questions or comments in the chat? And if not, what I'll do is I'll lead us through our music therapy activity.
We only have one comment, recent comment. This person says, I used music in my coaching before with those in alcohol recovery. It was an amazing experience for my clients.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think music helps people to think about someone who's in recovery or who has experienced trauma or, some difficult times in their life. Their sense of self can feel very fragmented, and there's also often really difficult feelings of guilt and shame and remorse. And for all those feelings, there are tons of beautiful songs out there that speak to those exact situations. And on a very basic level, it helps folks recognize that I'm not alone, right? That I'm not the only one who's going through this, or I'm not the only one who's made mistakes. And then the power of redemption, right? That there's redemption songs, but also just the sense of like being seen and heard. When we connect with music that really resonates with us, we feel seen and heard. When we're able to share that with others, it's like we're bringing them into our world. And any other comments,
Yes,
Azeta?
here's another one. This person says, I have begun having a YouTube channel in the background while working, and it is making such a difference in my stress level. It is rainy jazz cafe, coffee shop vibes.
I love the YouTube channels. I will put on similar stuff. Like Nick, so I didn't mention this earlier. I'm glad you mentioned that. Research has shown us that the most calming sounds to human beings are the sounds of birds and the sounds of water. And so when you're working, if you're, if you want to create a calmer state, having in the background sounds of birds, sounds of water, other sounds of nature is very, very calming. Again, we know that, like, if you listen to a song or a genre of music and it relaxes you, by all means, put that music on in the background. There's value in that. So I love that example. And if you go to YouTube, there's just an enormous amount of creativity where people have created both these visual soundscapes where it's either natural sounds or it's music, and it's with this whole kind of like visual representation that can really transport you into a different kind of emotional and mental space. Okay, I am going to, unless there's, I don't know if there's anything else in the chat,
There's a
Zeta.
few more, and I can just read them all, and that
Okay,
way
sure.
you can respond. So this one says, hold on. Okay. This one says, these are the reasons I became a music therapist. We have music therapy services at UK Healthcare, and I work with the babies in the NICU. So many positive outcomes for our patients, young and old.
Yes.
And then this one says, our bodies have a rhythm, breathing, walking, arm swinging, etc. Music has a rhythm as well. I believe when our bodies are out of rhythm, we have illness, and music can help us with that.
I'm totally with that. That's a was really well said. And I was also thinking about I talking about music therapy. I've used I'm not a trained music therapist. I just use music often in my therapy sessions, but I've often used it to bridge generational gaps in families to help build understanding between family members when all communication is kind of broken down. So yeah, I think we are as many songs as there are in the world. There's that many ways that we can use music to help us.
Here's a couple more.
Okay.
This one says, I have witnessed amazing things with Alzheimer's patients when music from their younger days is played. Suddenly, those that have lost the ability to communicate find a way to share joy.
Absolutely. It's really powerful for folks with Alzheimer's of being able to experience share joy. It's almost like you're bringing them home to themselves. And I think I've tried to emphasize that we grow up with music. Even when we're in our mother's womb, we are responding to music. And so it can very much be a way of grounding us, centering us, and transporting us, really. I think about music is so powerful in that if you hear a certain song, it can transport you back to a very specific memory. And yeah, it's a great intervention for that reason.
All right, here's a few more. I keep my local radio station on during the day and it helps me get through the day. And then this one says, I am graduated from 1991 with a degree in music therapy. However, I now work in occupational therapy and I use music daily with my rehab patients. This
I
one's,
would.
oh, go
Oh, I
ahead.
was just gonna say. I just took my mom to a speech therapy this morning, and I heard, and they were doing in the same room or the adjacent room. They were doing physical therapy or occupational therapy, and they were playing music. And as soon as they turned the music on, the patient they were working with became much more engaged, and you could see how the whole experience shifted for her.
All right. This one says, I have begun having a YouTube channel in the background while working, and it is making such a difference. Oh, no, sorry. Oh, that's a repeat of that one. I think somebody commented on it and it made it pop up again. And this one says, I have playlists on Spotify geared towards different moods or activities. And this other one says, I tend to put on classical music to help me go to sleep, go back to sleep.
I love it. I love it. And so I think what people are sharing is now this self-awareness, right? There's a self-awareness there. There's an emotional intelligence to what people are sharing. And I think, one of the things that happens when we get really stressed out is we sometimes deprive ourselves from the things we most need. And in that sense, music can be a way of slowing things down for us, physiologically lowering our stress levels, slowing our heart rate, but also just from a kind of allowing us to be more present. So I love the way people are describing. And these are all great examples for others to experiment with if you haven't done some of these things. And any more, Rosetta?
No, that's the last comment.
All right, great. I'm normally put way too many slides, but I was trying to really make sure we had opportunity to do this. activity. And I realized, let's see if I can come back and just show you the questions. I'm going to play just a sample of 10 different songs. And if you have some pen and paper, I would encourage you to get that out for this activity. Or you could use just like the notepad on your phone. Before I connect to my audio, I'm just going to pull this back up. You all might have already read it. We're going to listen to the samples. And what I would like for you to try to do with each song, so I don't know if we'll get through all 10, but we're going to try and do samples of 10 songs, is that either during the song or in the brief pause between songs, write down what emotion or what emotion or emotions that the song evoked in you. So it could be one word, it could be a couple words. Then see if you could write down some kind of, if you were going to like name this song, like what would be a word that would, that comes to mind for the song, or if there was an image that came to mind during the song, jot that down. And then finally, the third thing is just to rate it on a 1 to 10 scale. 10 represents that it really resonated with you, it really connected with you. And 1 represents that there was like no connection at all. And so jot down, you know, on a 1 to 10, and this isn't necessarily 1 to 10, how much did I love it or hate it? This is like 1 to 10, how much did it connect with me, or did it emotionally move me? So if it impacts you, if it emotionally moves you, put that at, you know, a higher score. If you don't have an emotional reaction or it didn't connect with you, put that at a lower score. And so I'm going to come switch over now to audio. Each song will be a sample of about a minute to a minute and a half. Azetta, once I start playing the songs, if some reason it's not working, just holler at me. And I'm going to come over to my playlist here. So I try to. So here we will start with the first song. Okay, what emotions or emotion arose for you? Is there something you would name it, or is there an image that comes to mind? And then how did it resonate for you on a 1 to 10 scale? And while you're jotting that down, I'm hoping that you are just getting the audio and not the visual. Is that accurate? Is that it's just the audio?
Yes, just the audio.
Okay.
It sounded great.
Good. Are we going to hop over to our second song?
Que mal amor
Again, if you can, what emotion did it evoke? Is there a name or image that comes to mind? And then on a 1 to 10, how much did it resonate? We're going to move to our next song. Okay, and again, what emotions arose for you? What would be a name or an image for this song? And then on a 1 to 10, how much did it resonate? We're now going to go to our fourth song.
It's 4 in the morning, the end of December. I'm writing you now just to see if you're better. New York is cold, but I like where I'm living. There's music on Clinton Street all through the evening. I hear that you're building your little house deep in the desert. You're living for nothing now. I hope you're keeping some kind of record. Yes, and Jane came by with a lock of your hair. She said that you gave it to her that night that you planned to go clear.
Okay, again, what emotions arise? What would be a name or an image for the song? And on a 1 to 10, how much does it resonate? We're going to go ahead and switch to our next song.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll do emotion or emotions, name or an image, and then on a 1 to 10, how much it resonated. Now we'll hop to our next song. Emotion, name or image, and on a 1 to 10, how it resonated. And now to our next song.
You got an organ going there. No wonder the sound has so much body.
A emotion, name or image, and then a 1 to 10, how much it resonated. We'll do our next song. Okay, same thing. Emotion, name or image, and then 1 to 10 resonance. And our next song. Okay, again, emotions, name or an image, and then 1 to 10, how it resonated. And the second, we will do our final song. Okay, and that's our final song. If you can name an emotion or emotions that song conjured up, a name for it or an image for it, and then on a 1 to 10, how much it resonated. And I know we're coming up at the end of our hour. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you really briefly the songs. Maybe I can get to many seconds. Okay. And what I would encourage you to do is go, Azetta is going to share these slides with you. I would encourage you to go through and the songs that you resonated the most with that may suggest that the emotion in that song is an emotion that you often feel or an emotion that you are currently feeling. And that can then be a starting point to ask yourself, what is this emotion about? And so let me go ahead and show you the songs. These are our 10 songs. When Azetta sends out the slides, you'll be able to click on any of those links to listen to them. You can also listen to them in their entirety. I know we're at the end of the hour. I hope that that activity was enjoyable for you all. Azetta, I will turn it back over to you.